Ready? It's a drunk tank, podcast, with Gus, and Jeff, and Bernie, and Joel, and Matt, and other people, like Gav,
Gavino?
It's a drunk tank, podcast.
Drunk tank,
podcast. There's something about acoustic, you know. Songs that are just touches the heart.
Oh, I wanted to throw my panties.
I did throw my panties.
Nice.
I think everyone who listens to the Drunk Tank has a guitar. Like, there's no there's no trombone players. Or there's no piano players.
The violin guy.
It's like going through college.
Or maybe I just really like the acoustic guitar and I just throw all those other ones away.
How many? So you like every time a guy with a recorder sends one in, you throw it away.
Yeah, fucking delete.
Gus does throw his panties every time.
Hey-o.
Hey, it's a podcast. This is number 35. Who knew we would last this long?
Of how many?
I just want to say I got in a lot of trouble from now till the last time I was here because I wanted to talk about Zombieland. And I was like, I'm not sure if I should talk about Zombieland. And Gus was like, yeah, go for it. And needless to say, I got a lot of hate.
Why?
Mails. People were like, you spoiled it for me.
Ah, fuck him. Fuck
him. I feel genuinely bad about it.
No. By the time you talked about it, that movie had been out like 3 weeks.
It's true.
I feel genuinely bad about it. So, I mean, that said, I'm never going to talk about Zombieland.
And you also said you were going to talk about Zombieland. Pause.
I'm not going to talk about Zombieland.
Joel, I think you're missing the point of the emails.
I am going to talk about Modern Combat 2, though.
He's never
Modern Combat 2. What's Modern Combat 2?
It's the sister game to Modern Warfare.
Modern Warfare. Combat and Warfare 2.
Last night, like 10 times in a row, my wife asked me, what's the name of this game again?
What's
the name of this game again? I had to give her the fucking box. I was like, here, just hold on to this. Anytime you're going to ask me the question, look at the box.
Why is that important to her, what the name of the game
is? I don't know. I have no idea.
What is the name of the game?
Call of Duty Modern Warfare 2.
It's not Call of Duty 6 Modern Warfare
2? No.
It should be called Call of Duty Kick Fucking Asshole.
Yeah.
All over the neighborhood is what it should be called because the game is awesome.
Why did it say asshole?
I know, really.
It's taking it to a really creepy level. Yeah. Not kick ass, kick asshole.
Yeah, brown shoes now.
It's good to have a specific
thing. Have you played it all yet, Bernie, or are you still
nope.
A little busy.
I can kind of sit out this discussion because I'm not a Modern Warfare fan, I wouldn't say. Everyone else in the world seems to love these games.
Why?
No, it's not that I don't like them. It's just like I'm really looking forward to Left 4 Dead 2 next week. And I have a copy of Modern Warfare. I will play it. But the last one that came out, which everyone loved and was the number one most played game on the Xbox 360 so far probably... I never played a single round of multiplayer on that. I have 1,000 points in that game. I got them all in one weekend, and then I was done with the game.
I don't think that game is great, too, I think.
I don't think I played any multiplayer of Call of Duty Modern Warfare either. I think I played it like 2 or 3 months after it came out, and my rationale was, everyone's really good at this game now. I'm not going to subject myself to that.
Yeah, but why didn't you play multiplayer? There's one reason you didn't play multiplayer.
Because of Halo 3.
No.
No achievements?
No achievements.
Oh.
You'd have played the shit out of multiplayer if it had achievements.
I would have felt obligated to, yeah.
Yeah.
And it's a good multiplayer. It's very super deep, and it has like a reward system that I think pretty much works.
Yeah, it's got a leveling system too, kind of similar to Halo. It seems pretty cool.
Don't you unlock better weapons as you get better?
Yes.
Yeah.
That seems like an...
You also get like points you can spend for doing good things in the game.
Absolutely.
Playing well.
And the point you're about to make is it's a little unfair, is what you're about to say, maybe for someone who's just jumping in versus...
Yeah, give the level 50 a bazooka.
You know, it's okay. It's not as bad as you think.
I didn't feel that way at all. Like, when we were playing it, when we had the challenge last year, Finch was in town, and he was playing multiplayer, and I sat down and I played a couple levels, and I was no good, and I was still able to, like, unlock helicopter strikes and all that shit.
I will tell you that it's, like, amazing when you first start playing the game, and then if you're actually able to kill one of these guys, it's, like, a super high level, and grab his weapon, and then you get used to his weapon that's got, like, a laser scope, and blah, blah, blah. It's hard to go back.
So you can pick up the stuff that these people drop?
Absolutely, but it's not, you don't spawn with it, you know, so it's...
That's cool.
That is cool. Why would you need to spawn once you have the weapon? You kill
everyone. It's one of those things where you have to play it, and you understand it after you play it.
Yeah, I think I'm going to play Modern Warfare 2 multiplayer, though, it's out.
Can I ask you a question about that? Seeing a potential flaw in that system... Can you pick up your dead teammates' weapons?
Yes, you can.
Because while I don't spawn with it, I spawn right next to it.
I don't know if there's friendly fire in that game.
Yeah, there might not be friendly fire.
That's what it is. It's not friendly fire. Yeah. You're absolutely right. Not friendly fire.
I see.
Yeah. So that you know, there shouldn't be. I don't think.
I think there should be friendly fire. I think that's an important part of any game.
I don't like the term friendly fire. There's nothing friendly about it.
But you should be allowed to boot anybody the first time they kill you.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I agree.
Maybe not with a grenade. Maybe you get a pass with a grenade.
What's your favorite video game that's not a Halo franchise?
I would. You mean a shooter game? Because I'm assuming that's what you mean. Probably Grawl. I like those games a lot.
More than Left 4 Dead?
No, no. Well, I don't consider Left 4 Dead to be in that category. Like, he just asked me, my brain went immediately to Grawl.
Yeah, he was thinking like military
I was thinking the alternative to Modern Warfare.
I just thought FPSs in general.
But no, but Left 4 Dead 2 is right up there with Halo for me. That Left 4 Dead series is awesome.
Yeah, it is.
Is there co-op functionality in Modern Warfare?
Modern Warfare 2, yes.
There is?
Yeah.
See, I feel like that's another leap forward.
There's not the single-player campaign, but they have those... I can't think of what they're called off the top of my head, but they have those missions you can do.
Oh, the special ops?
Special ops missions. Those are co-op.
Oh, I haven't done those yet, so I'm not sure.
Yeah, and there's achievements for all of them.
Let me ask a really simple question, then, to all of you. Does it live up to the hype?
I'm the least far out of everybody in this room next to you.
Doesn't matter. Does it live up to the hype so far?
To me, it absolutely lives up to the hype.
Really?
Yeah, I'm going to say something that's going to be weird, though, is that I'm not all the way through the game. I'm like 80% of the way through the game. And so without knowing the ending, I think the first one was maybe just a smidge better, but they're still both phenomenal games.
I think it's a good game. I don't think it's necessarily better than the last one. I think the last one was, kind of groundbreaking in a way. Right. And then this one... You know, it's just, you can only innovate so much beyond that, it seems like. That last game was so close to perfect.
They had tried to up the oh shit value in this game.
Absolutely.
And you get a little desensitized to it.
But it's still,
fucking tremendous.
Fucking great game.
And it's gorgeous, and it's fun, and it's really fucking cool, and super stressful.
Mm-hmm.
It also seems, from the outside, it seems very story-driven. Like, people want to know, did you get to this part? Have you gotten to this part yet?
Yeah, it feels more story-driven than the last one to me.
I can't tell you anything that happened in the last game. I remember there was a Ferris wheel. I remember there was a nuclear bomb that went off. I can't recall anything from the campaign, but I'll tell you what I can remember. I can tell you every single inch of that plane in the Mile High Achievement. Because I ran that thing about 250 times.
Yeah, I can still see. I probably ran it. I did not get through it as quickly as you. I probably ran it 400 times. And I can still see it in my head.
Pretty much straight.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because a run was about a minute and a half, if you were lucky.
Oh, God.
Wasn't the goal to do it in a minute?
The goal is to do it in...
2 minutes.
No, it was a minute, wasn't it?
We'll look it up.
55 seconds or something like that?
Yeah.
This game is the only game that I play where it's like I play it on... I go through the game on one setting, like an easier setting, and then I will go back and I will play it on harder settings. This is the only game that I do it on. And it's like a game where you're playing it on the easy settings, and in the back of your mind, you're like, oh, man, when I have to play this level, it's going to be a nightmare.
I'm playing it on regular right now, and there's some parts where I'm like, fuck, I keep dying and dying. Like, I cannot imagine playing this part on a harder difficulty.
I think that this might be why I'm not as into the game as I was the first one. Because on the first one, Bernie and I had to play it on veteran first time through. So it was truly challenging. And you got really invested in how well you played. And you paid the utmost attention because you had to give it 100% of your attention all the time. And because I'm doing videos for Achievement Hunter and I'm playing it on Recruit right now, so there's no challenge, really. You know? And I think that takes me out of it a bit.
Yeah,
so
I
think it might be a better game than it feels like for me right now playing it on Recruit.
I was watching you blow through some of that stuff on Recruit that was like making me so mad last night.
Yeah, right.
I was like, God, it's so easy now.
But even then, I do have moments in Recruit where I get stuck. You know, like on that breach thing where you watch me try like 8 times.
Yeah, sadly, it took you the same number of tries to get through the breach thing as it did me on a harder difficulty.
Yeah.
You know, Jeff, I know what you mean, though, because last time I played it, we were doing that race where, to get all the achievements, and there was a massive incentive. Like,
right.
I could have won, and if I'd have won, I theoretically would have gotten something from you for winning. And then, you know, likewise for you, you were playing, and you knew that if you won, you would get something from me, and then if you lost, you wouldn't have to give up anything. You knew that going into it. I didn't have that luxury that you did
right in
that achievement. Because we're now, 2 years now? Anniversary of that?
Gosh, when did that game come out?
Yeah, it was 2 years ago.
2 years ago.
What was the...
The bet was whoever...
Let's not rehash
the game first to get all the achievements first would then tell the other person, you have to do an achievement
What was that achievement?
Specifically, I chose Dead Rising's 7-day survivor achievement, which, Jeff, at any point in the last 2 years...
I have an out for Jeff.
A lot of 7 days have passed since the last 2 years.
I have an out for Jeff.
What's that?
Like, I heard the story about Dead Rising being responsible, the game being responsible for overclocking the processor on 360s and killing 360s.
Rumor. Total rumor. But
I don't know.
Don't use the word overclocking. It's not overclocking.
I'm sorry, not over. What is the term?
It just
listen, I don't want to do this. I'm not going to. I don't want to get into the thing where I defend myself because that just makes Bernie mad, and I have to sit in this room with him for the rest of the day, and he's going to be pissy with me all goddamn day, and he'll yell at me about some dumb shit that has nothing to do with me. So I'd rather just move on and talk about something else.
Do you remember when you won the "Can you get 10,000 points in a week" bet?
I won it in 3 days.
You won it in 3 days. How many? In how many days did I pay you?
Like 3 days.
Yeah.
It's pretty fast.
It's $1,000, by the way.
Yeah. Thank you for that.
And in 2 years, you have been able to get a goddamn video game achievement.
You know what I did with that $1,000?
I have no idea. Have you played Dead Rising at all since then in the last 2 years?
Yeah. I went back and played it this year.
You could turn that into a video, cool. Maybe.
Yeah, maybe.
Can we put like a high-pitched filter on his voice just for the rest of the podcast? Can we do that? How does that feel to not fulfill a bet? Just like, I'm not going to do it.
I seriously, I don't want to do it. I don't want to get into it with you because I don't feel like I didn't fulfill the bet. I feel like the bet changed on me.
You know, the good news is that his wife defends him and says, oh, he shouldn't have to do it. Like, that's going to sway me in any way whatsoever.
To be fair, my wife does not defend me very often. So. She's not usually on my side.
That is true.
So when I feel like when she is, it's deserved.
I heard that your kid threatened your wife with physical violence the other day.
She did.
No, it actually wouldn't stand up in court.
Millie just, she's smart. She just turned 4, and she's starting to get to that creepy age. Like, you can see this picture she made me last night, which is Daddy and the Ghosts, which is kind of scary if you look at it.
I'll take a picture of that for the link dump.
And then she just turned 4, and she wanted to watch a movie the other day, and Griffin said, no, we're going to go grocery shopping.
Wait, she drew that?
Yeah, Millie drew it last night. And Daddy and the Ghosts.
That is that's actually a little disturbing.
It's pretty scary, right? But not as scary as this story. The other day, Griffin, Millie said, Mom, I want to watch a movie. I want to watch, I think, Totoro or some shit. And Griffin said, no, we're going to go to the grocery store. You can watch the movie later, maybe, if you're a good girl. And Millie said, Mommy, it would be sad if you broke your nose. And Griffin said, excuse me? And she goes, I'm saying, it would hurt really bad if you broke your nose. It would be sad. And Griffin goes, are you threatening me? And Millie goes, you'd have to get a new nose, and that would hurt.
Wow.
She's doing like a mafia-style fucking shakedown on my wife.
Did she get to watch her movie?
No.
And she's going to be a pit boss when she grows up.
Yeah. No kidding. Boy, you got a lot of nice things around here, Mommy. Be ashamed if something got broken.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so I don't know where she got that from, but I mean, she watches The Godfather a lot. Aside from that.
Between you and me, I'd let her watch the movie. She sleeps in your house, you know what
I mean?
I
know, dude. And she doesn't sleep as much as us, too. Like, yeah. I always wake up at like 5 in the morning and Millie's just laying next to me, and I have like, what the fuck? Oh.
You start locking your door.
If she wanted to be dangerous, I could wake up with a knife in my fucking stomach for all I know.
Or with a horse's head next to you in the bed.
Or the cat's head. She'd be like, I told you to buy me the dress. So,
it's scary. It's definitely scary.
I'll bet you'll let me watch the movie now, Daddy. You know what I always want to suggest to somebody? We just passed Halloween, and on my neighborhood, there's girls that it's a set of quadruplets, you know? And I always thought if I had little girls...
Little girls, not like hot teenage...
No, I mean like 4 or 5.
Oh, okay,
like,
cool.
Like your daughter. For Halloween, I would have to make them dress up like the Shining Girls, especially if I had twins. I would just have to do that.
That would be
one
awesome.
Year. God, how creepy would that be?
Yeah, that would be fucking really creepy.
But if there's 3 of them, then how would...
You can let the other ones be Strawberry Shortcake and have normal childhoods. You know? While Dad creeps out the entire neighborhood, just stand in the window and stare at everybody.
Nice. So, did you see that EA laying off some people?
1,500 people, dude.
Yeah.
That's fucking... really sad.
That's pretty major.
It's a shitty time of year to be laid off, too, I would wager.
I didn't even think about that, too. Yeah.
It's fucking horrible.
I feel like they reported their quarter, like, a week or 2 weeks before that, for some reason. I want to think that. And they were like, don't worry, Wall Street, next quarter we're guiding up, and our profit margins are going to be increased.
Well, supposedly one of the reasons they had to lay off 1,500 people was because they bought some casual game company, and they needed to free up some cash.
$250 million for what was it, Joy Walk or something?
I've never heard of the company.
Yeah, it does games for like Facebook and Twitter and this, that, and the other thing.
Yeah,
and they're talking about this now. Like a lot of developers are saying, you know, if there's not $1 million development of a game for like an iPhone going on right now, it will happen soon. Like,
oh, really?
That's where we're going, I think.
I would think we got to be getting close. I mean, we have Assassin's Creed for the iPhone at this point.
I think a lot of dollars are flowing into that.
Yeah.
Into that space.
There's a lot of cool stuff on the iPhone now. Civilization's on there, SimCity's on there,
mm-hmm.
and they're very robust games. Yeah. I don't feel like I'm missing anything.
Oregon Trail's on there.
No kidding. Is it really?
Is it really?
Yeah, it's like a...
Shit.
My wife will get that.
It's like a fucking 70 megabyte download.
Now get
it. Maybe bigger. Yeah, it's pretty serious. It's good, too. I played it.
Wow.
I got to Oregon.
Nice, dude. Congratulations.
My son died on the way.
Cholera.
I think an eagle picked him up and flew off with him or something.
You know, is that the lamest reward for any game of all time? You're in Oregon. You made it.
Congratulations.
You ran out of land. There's now water in front of you. You can't walk anymore.
Which is too bad, because you're in Oregon.
Enjoy our bland food and ugly women. It's one of the things we talk about. My wife's a beautiful lady, but she's from Oregon. But when we went on our first commercial shoot with the Wyden Kennedy guys, this was like 3 years ago, Gus, or so, maybe longer.
Yeah, 3 or 4 years ago.
They're based in Portland.
They're based in Portland, and in the coolest building I've ever seen in my entire life. But we were chatting with them about Portland, because I'd spent a lot of time there because of family stuff. And I asked them how they liked living in Portland, and they said, well, it's a bring-your-own-girlfriend kind of state. That's the only thing I'm going to say about that.
Really?
They go, really? Wow. That bad, huh? And he goes, yeah, there's not a looker there. So nice. if you want to have a good time in Oregon, you gotta import.
It's like getting to a party at 3 a.m, you know, after it's already peaked.
And if you're a female listening to this podcast from Oregon,
prove us wrong.
Which is highly unlikely.
Nudes.
I was gonna say there's probably a reason why we don't post a lot of pictures of this podcast being made. there's not a bunch of good looking dudes in this room in Austin either. But one thing about Joel, though, I want to point out is that Joel is secretly a financial wizard. I don't think many people know that about Joel.
He's kind of like a savant, in a way.
Yes.
Like Rain Man.
Like, incapable of normal, everyday, like, tasks and interactions. But if you put, a copy of Money magazine in front of him, fucking...
Yes, magazine. If it doesn't have power, that's always a plus, you know? But like, he knows when EA reported their quarter, and he keeps up with all of that.
Yet I can't get my computer to boot up in the morning.
If Joel and I could get together, we could actually...
be the dumbest person ever.
We know we could create a pretty decent financial team, because I'm very good at predicting when shit's about to fall apart, and he's very good at predicting when we've reached the bottom and we're about to start coming back up.
That's true.
Like, I'm good at storm clouds are coming, and he's great at, like, oh, everything's fine.
Joel's also good at telling you what stocks he should have bought 9 months ago.
That's true.
That is true.
I called it on the day.
Joel is
you
the king
were there.
Of that.
I called it on the day. I said it again and again and again. I will forever remember that walk back from China.
I will definitely say this. I remember, dude. I was like, why don't you put your money in it then? And you're like, I can't do it. I just can't do it. I can't pull the trigger.
It's gone up, like, 600% since?
Yeah. I will say that the second we moved our 401k into a new plan, and we all had to like pick new 401k shit. I just went to Joel and I just handed him a piece of paper and I said, "What? Just check off."
No, you lie. I went to Joel and did that. Then you were like, "That's a good idea."
I did it too, and we both did it. And he was like, "You want this? That's all you want."
And,
like, okay,
it's
really
doubled.
Lucky with the timing.
It's doubled since March.
It's doubled since March. Yeah, thank
Yay.
You, Joel.
Well, mutual fund doubling. Well, I mean, the major indices have been up huge. So
whatever indices means, absolutely, I'm right there with you.
I love the indice.
You know, when you make a 401k plan, we made it, we actually have to pick 25 plans that then we can choose from, and then all our future employees will get to choose from as well.
Future employees.
Is EA hiring yet? I picked 13 of them, and I left 12 slots open and said, Joel, anything else you want in here, basically, because I know nobody else gives a shit.
Yeah.
So Joel got to pick the last half of our plans, basically.
I pick on names that rhyme or come close to rhyming. So.
I would think you would pick names that sound like boner.
I did that, too. If I could sexually manipulate it in some way, I'd do that.
That's why we used to play WoW on Bone Chewer, because it was like the most...
the funniest thing. It's 1 hour away from being the funniest server ever.
You know, also, when we sent out the prospectus for all the different plans, I'm pretty sure that Jeff was picking his based on the cover art.
The hotter the chick, the more money, right?
That's an excellent point.
Yeah. Hot chicks are attracted to money.
Look how big those fake boobs are.
Yeah. It was totally depending on the cover of the prospectus what the happy retired people were doing. Like, if they were at home, not so cool. If they were out, like, on a beach, Jeff was like, that's way better. I gotta pick that one.
I don't want to be 60 and looking at my laptop and like garden. That's retarded. I want to play shuffleboard. I'm going to go with those guys. Hey, speaking of EA, we only talked about half of that story. In addition to laying off 1,500 people, they slashed their release schedule in half next year.
I'm glad you brought it back around. I was hoping we'd talk about that.
Yeah, that's just a crazy thing to me is that they're going to go from releasing 50 to 60 titles next year to 30.
Well, where's EA at right now, right? I mean, it's like the Madden franchise, like, that didn't do very well, right?
No, Madden's done really well this year.
Oh, it has. It
rebounded in the second month and did really well. It's up, like, 3% over last year's Madden.
How did Brutal Legend do?
Brutal Legend, I don't know. I don't know how.
I know Madden disappointed on the Wii, but I mean that's
yeah, but that's
no surprise.
Did they ever settle that weird lawsuit about Brutal Legend?
Yeah, I think so. And also it was Brutal Legend.
Yeah, they did because they couldn't have released the game until they settled it.
What lawsuit's that?
It was a weird thing where like Activision and EA were fighting over Brutal Legend, who had to take it, and then it turned out to be an awesome game. I don't really understand what happened.
I think what happened was, you remember Activision when Activision acquired Blizzard last year? You know, they acquired several companies at the same time. And one of the company, and after they acquired all these companies, they looked at the projects they were working on, and then there were certain projects that they cut off. Like Ghostbusters was one.
Yeah.
Brutal Legend was another, and there were just a bunch of titles. Wet was another one of them.
I think 50 Cent might have been one,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, Blood on the Sand was another one, and they just cut them. And so other publishers had to pick them up. But I think Brutal Legend was like the one exception amongst all of them. I think they cut it, but there was like some confusion about whether or not someone else could release the game.
It's weird, too, because... Yeah. Ghostbusters and Brutal Legend were great games, you know? I really enjoyed Ghostbusters, and Brutal Legend is just fucking tremendous.
I thought it was great. I hope there's a Brutal Legend, too. Right?
I wish that all video games had stories that well-written and engrossing, you know? You get spoiled by stuff like that.
And it had, like, humor to it, and it was funny, and it was, like, not... It's like everything's so heavy. Like, Call of Duty's heavy, heavy, heavy. Brutal Legend wasn't heavy.
No, not at all.
You know, it's, like, nice.
It's a show your friend who doesn't play video games kind of game.
I should clarify what I said. Activision didn't acquire Blizzard. Activision and Blizzard merged.
Right. Yeah.
You know, I think that video games are getting more and more like movies all the time, and that's what you just said right there is the way video games are, the way movies are. If it's not based on an existing franchise or an adaptation of a movie or a remake or something like that.
It's like hard to launch, right?
It's very hard to get out there.
It's like you almost have to have a name associated with it or whatever, like with Brutal Legend.
That's probably why they tied Jack Black to it.
Right.
Yeah, it's a real shame because especially EA, who had such a bad reputation for such a long time, the last 2 or 3 years has done, a really good job of producing some pretty, groundbreaking and innovative games. I mean, Brutal Legend is unlike anything you've played before. Mirror's Edge was awesome. Dead Space was really, really cool.
They've had some good new IP. It seems like a lot of the game industry is just rehashing and making sequels.
Yeah.
But it's good to see the new properties out there.
Speaking of rehashing sequels, I heard they're rebooting the Medal of Honor franchise now.
Yeah, I saw that rumor. I haven't read the story. I didn't know what the deal is. I heard that there's going to be details in the months ahead.
Yeah. Why wouldn't you do that?
Yeah, sure.
Is anyone else tired of shooting Nazis?
Nope. I never get told.
Really. It's like the one group of people. It's like Nazis and zombies are like the two times you can shoot people and it's okay.
It's true.
It's true. That's
why World at War had Nazi zombies and it was perfect. It was like the Venn diagram of killing.
acceptable killing.
Yeah. You know that Left 4 Dead 2 commercial that we made? It's really amazing how the ratings boards don't consider zombies to be people. And you can show much more violent things on a TV commercial because everyone just recognizes that's a zombie.
Mm-hmm.
And you even choose ones that look more zombie-ish so people won't mistake it for a person.
And then it's okay to hit them with the baseball bat.
Boy, that is always a tricky, tricky thing because it seems like on every single commercial project, it seems like there's a different set of rules from the ESRB regarding what you can show and what you can't show.
Yeah, they have a set of rules like for every scenario. And then when you do sports games, you have to bring in players' associations and stuff.
Yep.
It's fucking ridiculous.
Like, I can't remember if we talked about this, but that email...
I think we have.
We already probably talked about it.
We talked about making a shirt out of it on the podcast, I think.
The best rule to me is how you cannot have a gun barrel pointed directly at the screen or at someone who's looking at your advertisement.
But yeah, getting back to the EA thing yet again, you were saying that you thought Madden underperformed when it actually did pretty well. And then FIFA. This year's FIFA is the fastest-selling sports game of all time.
Well, that's a global franchise, right?
But EA, like, what's his name? John Reticello or Resitello?
I'm not sure.
Yeah, the CEO of EA pretty much threw Wii under the bus and blamed Nintendo for all their lackluster sales.
Isn't everything associated with
the
Wii?
Yeah, they said that every multi-platform title fails on the Wii, essentially. And that there's no real market there.
It seems like it's just a different crowd.
It is a different crowd. But he basically said they bet on the wrong console during that quarter or in that year, and it just buried him.
Wow, it's crazy.
Yeah.
Well, Peter Moore's over there too.
He's in charge of EA Sports.
EA Sports, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. He left Xbox after the whole Red Ring thing kind of came to a head, and they recognized it was going to be a $1 billion loss to fix all that. then he was off to EA, and you know, now EA's doing that kind of stuff. It's kind of like, you know, the industry in general is kind of, you know.
I bet Peter Moore doesn't wear a lot of tank tops these days. I just want to show off his Halo tattoo on the EA employees.
Oh, yeah, that's probably true. That's probably true. You know, this
was
gonna,
that real? Did he really get that tattoo?
Real, I'm pretty sure.
This is going to date me a little bit, but every time I see EA in writing, Electronic Arts, I don't think of it in my head as being EA. I think of it as being EOA. Because
really?
The original logo for EA was an E that was square, and then the A was a pyramid, but between them they had a sphere. And I looked at that all the time when I was a kid, like when I played Dr. J versus Larry Bird.
That was a great game.
And I just got in my head that that company was EOA, and I thought maybe the O came from the in the middle of electronic, and that's where they pulled it out. I pulled it up just to prove that that was the original
logo. I remember that logo. That.
So, to this day, I'm like, that thing, that company is so misbranded in my head, I still think of them as EOA.
It was probably a good move to get rid of that circle.
Yeah, why did they have that? I don't know why they had it. I guess they thought it looked cool.
And they needed to space out the E and the A so that you could see all of Electronic Arts to make it the same size or something.
It was probably something they could actually render in 2-bit graphics back then.
Probably had to lay off a couple dudes for getting rid of that O.
They laid off the sphere. That was their first cut.
No, they laid off the curve department.
After Dr. J 89 didn't sell so well, they had to do some layoffs, and Sphere made the cut.
Did you see also that Star Trek Online has a ship date now?
Does it really?
Yeah.
When is it?
February 2nd, 2010. Or for the nerd-inclined, Stardate 6355
4.5. I was going to ask him what Stardate that would be.
Guess who's going to be playing Star Trek Online?
Who?
Me.
Are you?
Are you?
Yeah, well, my wife is a huge Trekkie, and she's into MMOs. You know, she loves WoW. And so we had a conversation a while back about how I was explaining to her how obviously she and I are going to play Knights of the Old Republic together, because why wouldn't you play the Old Republic? And she goes, I don't care about Star Wars. Is there a Star Trek one? And I was like, yeah, of course. Oh, fuck, yes. There's a Star Trek one. So now we'll be playing that.
Well, don't you guys think that Star Trek lends itself better to MMO than Star Wars does?
I don't know. We'll see.
I definitely think it does. I mean,
why?
It's exploration and talking to people and being bored for long periods of time.
Large block text bubbles that you have to read.
Yeah, and there's even like low classes of people that just get killed all the time, so it's acceptable.
It's all about diplomacy.
Yeah, just don't roll a character with a red shirt.
Yeah, no kidding.
Then you'll be okay. What does anyone know what timeline does this fucking Star Trek Online take place in?
Dude, I don't know.
What does that mean?
Like, does it take place in the reboot timeline or the normal timeline? And if it takes place in the normal timeline, like, where in the universe, or when in the universe does it take place?
That's a really good question. There's a lot of...
That is a really good question.
Like, are we going to be playing Nemesis, or are we going to be playing, you know,
I want to serve
Wrath
in Captain
Khan.
Janeway.
You know how I date all of the Star Trek timeline? Is on the letter of Enterprise that they're currently on. Because to me, Star Trek started with whenever they built the first Enterprise, and then they've blown up, like, what, 6 of them now? And they're on to F at this point?
Yeah.
So that to me is, like, that's how you date the Star Trek franchise.
You think they'd quit giving him fucking ships?
You need to stop building Enterprise.
I mean, how much money is that? It's like, you did what again? Oh, god damn it. Got another loss this quarter.
Yeah, you don't know what the lifespan of those things are, you know? It could be a long time. Where the hell do you get the materials to build all those goddamn ships? These things are huge.
Hey, especially when you can't invade planets and take their resources. You have to, like, negotiate and be diplomats and play nice with them.
That's very true. And if they don't have warp technology, you can't interfere.
That's the main thing that I'm surprised no one, like, everyone talks about that latest Star Trek movie. And it was like, oh, it was a good movie or whatever. But it's like that little caveat at the end where they change everything.
It was awesome, right?
That was great.
It's just confusing. It's just,
it's
totally
not.
Fine. I don't know. Well, it's like you said, it's like, what timeline is the game going to take place? It's just so muddled now. And it's just, I don't know. It just seems like the biggest.
I found it. The game takes place 30 years after the events in Star Trek Nemesis. The game starts in 2409.
That doesn't help me a bit. What is Star Trek Nemesis?
Nemesis was the last, like, Frakes movie,
it's
right?
Yeah, it was the one where the Romulans were trying to make, like, the Picard clone, and...
It was the one where Data died, right? Is that a spoiler for a 4-year-old movie? I'm sorry.
I think it might be older
than
4 years.
It was the one where Data, like, committed suicide to save the ship.
Yeah.
It was cool.
So Data will not be in the Star Trek MMO.
It's a great... If you guys watch the movie, look out for the scene where Data kills himself. It's really cool.
So, I'm gonna lay some money down. I'll put a bet with you guys right now. I'm going to say within about a month of the launch, either before or after Star Trek Online, that Fox News will run some kind of story about how it's socialist propaganda to indoctrinate people. Like, what is the impact of playing in the Star Trek universe?
I cannot wait to hear what Fox News has to say about Modern Warfare 2.
Oh, really?
I mean, there's a level, and again, you know, if you haven't played the game, this is like level 2. So if you haven't played the game, this is your own fault. There's a level where you walk into an airport and start mowing down all the passengers who are waiting to get on planes.
No way, really?
You kill every civilian in the airport.
Your mission is to kill every civilian in there.
I've never seen a game where you just see hordes of people just getting mowed down.
Yeah, like when you first put the game in your Xbox, it pops up a warning and it's like, there is shocking imagery in this game. Do you wish to have the option to skip it? And then you can either say, I won't be offended, or yes, please skip it.
And they even say, this will not affect your achievement progress.
Here's the question. Did you guys start mowing down innocent
civilians? I didn't fire my gun at all.
Oh, yeah, I was looking for people who were like hiding or hurt.
And you,
no, dude.
Oh, yeah.
You took those guys out, huh? Oh, yeah.
I walked very sadly. I tried to, like, stand in the way of people that were, like, hobbling around so that the guys couldn't see them.
See, I imagine,
I tried to defend the people,
I imagined being in that security line, and I was playing a mini game in my head where I was like, which of these people would have taken the longest in the security line? And those are the people I was going after.
Okay, that makes sense.
I was like,
now.
You still have your shoes
sense.
On. You think you can take that bottle of water through the metal detector? What's wrong with you? You know?
Okay, it makes total sense now.
In addition to the, like, Bernie's Fox News comment, I think the thing that we'll definitely see is, like, 2 months after Star Trek comes out, it'll follow the path of all non-WoW MMOs. 2 months after it comes out, they'll announce they have 1 million subscribers, and that's awesome. And then in another 2 months, they'll shut down 90% of the servers.
It seems to be...
That's like the move, right?
Yeah, the move. I think it seems like when the game launches, everyone's always afraid that... they're not going to have enough capacity to serve the players.
Right.
And then they end up having too much.
Yeah. It's sad.
Yeah. I mean, it's better to have, you know, more crowded servers than to have, you know, totally empty servers where no one's playing.
I totally agree.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Nothing worse than being in WoW, walking around and seeing nobody.
Hey, Gus, did you get your PS3 Netflix disc yet?
Yeah, I did. I haven't put it in my...
Oh, you did get it?
Yeah, I got it on Friday. I haven't put it in my PlayStation yet, though.
That's pretty cool that you got it that quickly, though.
Yeah.
I just started to read reviews about it I think around Friday. Mm-hmm. And not very good.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I heard that it was very similar to the Roku interface.
I don't know. I saw a video of the interface. It did look like the Roku. It looked like a little more elegant than the Roku interface. But the complaints are all just that it's really slow. Like, super slow off the disc.
Well, that sucks. Oh, I guess that makes sense.
That's a shame.
You know, did you see, Jeff, that the new wireless adapter for the Xbox 360 also came out?
The N adapter?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm excited.
I don't have an N network at home.
I don't have an N network, but it makes me want to get an N network now.
Can I? You and I live about 3 blocks from each other. Can we just...
We'll see if we can hook that up. Yeah. I'll put it up on top of a tree.
Thanks.
What's interesting to me is that it looks like it's black.
Yeah, it does look like it's black. It's also got two antennas.
And if it's black, that's very cool because they have stopped making black accessories, and I wish they would make them, because the white ones stand out. You know, there's now a red console for Resident Evil 5, there's a green console, now this is the Modern Warfare black and gray console. I guess the white one would work okay there, but the black memory card works better with every other console, even like the green Halo 3 one.
Sure.
You know, than the white one just kind of sticking out there like a buck tooth or something like that. You know, and there's white chat pads that don't go with the controllers anymore.
Yeah, it's annoying.
Yeah.
You feel the same way about your tacos, don't you?
Oh, that blackjack taco?
Oh, God.
I made these guys all try those black tacos, and they were squishy and disgusting. So if you're a fan of Taco Bell, you might want to skip that. I don't know what Monterey Jack sauce is. I don't know what that is.
If you're a fan of your body, you might want to skip it.
Yeah.
If you live in Portland, don't worry about it. Or if you live in Oregon, don't worry about it. You know, eat it all you want.
Now we're going to alienate everybody who lives in Oregon.
This is great, too, because I'm probably going to end up retiring to Oregon someday and end up living in Portland for the rest of my life.
Nah, don't do that. Don't retire where your wife's from, because...
Well, she's from Corvallis, but,
well...
Portland's 3 hours away.
I have a little bit of experience of, you know, moving back where my wife is
from.
Oh,
yeah, yeah.
They're not that interested.
After
about 5 minutes.
Luckily, I like Portland. And it's not like there's a lot of hot chicks to distract me, so...
I'd like to retire to Australia.
Yeah.
I love Australia.
I love Australia, too. I'm starting to lean more towards New Zealand, personally.
I want to go to Scotland. Bernie and Joel and I went to Scotland for a while back, and I didn't want to leave. That was the most chill place I've ever been in
my
life. So
I guess once we're done and once we all retire, we're all going to move to the furthest corners of the earth away from each other.
Yeah.
We're going to see how many oceans we can put between us.
Scatter. We'll shut the doors and then scatter to the winds.
We're like, there's only 3 continents between me and Jeff. How can I get a fourth in there?
Jeff likes those rainy environments, man.
It was rainy and cold or whatever, but dude, it was just like the entire city basically existed to drink and facilitate drinking. Do you remember that?
The one thing I remember about
that. And the crepe trucks, the crepes and hot dogs? Come on, dude. I could eat that every day for the rest of my life.
The best hot dog I've ever had in my life was in Scotland and was served by a guy from, I think, Bosnia.
Absolutely.
And it was awesome.
Yeah.
Is that code for something?
Yeah, no. No, not the code for anything.
Wasn't Slobodan Milosevic or anything, was it?
It was. Was it?
It might have been. it's disgusting. I've always wanted to try that kebab truck that's like over here at like 7th and Trinity, a few blocks away from our office.
You should do it, dude.
I've never gotten around to it. I'm afraid of it because it's across the street from that homeless shelter.
I want to try the hot dog, the hamburger truck that's like 5 blocks down that sells Chesse burgers.
I went there once, but they weren't open.
They misspelled cheese, C-H-E-S-S-E.
Oh, you know what? That reminds me. A couple of podcasts ago, I was making fun of somebody misspelling calendar on the raid. And the way I said it was they spelled it D-A-R, calendar. But that wasn't what they spelled wrong. It was they spelled calendar C-A-L-A-N-D-A-R. They didn't put the E in the middle.
Right.
Yeah.
And so I sucked you guys in some kind of weird grammatical, like,
because we'd all seen it.
Yeah.
So everyone knew what you were talking about. But everyone who was listening who hadn't seen it on the raid, of course, thought that we were all idiots.
Right.
And we didn't know how to spell calendar.
Right.
Which is probably, we did. That is pretty accurate. We were all like laughing. Ha ha, calendar. And, meanwhile, Brandon's out there misspelling everything he types onto the server.
You didn't out him in the last podcast. You outed him this time.
Fucking Brandon.
You know, the two people I know that graduated from UT the most recently are Jack and Brandon, and they are both borderline retarded when it comes to grammar
and
spelling.
It's really funny because, you know, we'll be walking down the street and Jack will be talking and making grammatical mistakes, and then under his breath I can hear Jeff correcting him.
Oh,
like Jeff doesn't
nuts.
Even say it out loud, but it's like under his breath.
It just drives me nuts.
Those two guys, it's the first time in my life that I've noticed generational differences that come up in different conversation. Like, we got involved in the whole Yankees winning the World Series conversation, where it's like, these guys just don't have any... We got into this big debate about...
They don't know to hate the Yankees yet? Is that what you're
saying?
They
don't know to hate the Yankees. A lot of little stuff.
Yeah, that's
like that.
That'll come with time.
But I think I'm done with baseball, by the way.
Oh, are you?
Yeah.
Are you finally convinced that it's fixed?
You know what? There are so many overwhelming problems with baseball. You know, it's like, first of all, the more you watch baseball, if you watch baseball and you're a fan of baseball and you're serious about it, you'll discover that at some point you're going to be watching what happens in the offseason more than what takes place on the field. Because I've come to realize what occurs in the offseason means a million times more than what happens on the field.
Hey, I'm going to go to lunch. Do you guys want me to pick you up anything? I know Joel will be going for about 2 hours
I just say, Joel, really quickly, as a fellow baseball fan, I think the biggest problem with you in baseball, honestly, is that you're a Rangers fan.
It's true.
I mean, that doesn't help.
It's awful.
It's like...
Well, it's like they've created a sport where whoever spends the most money wins the games. It's like WWE wrestling.
I'm a French army fan, you know?
I only date women that have kids already. One day it's going to work out for me.
Now you're singling out singled mothers. I love it.
Well, you know they put out.
This will make you happy. This will make you really happy then, Joel. Have you guys seen what Sammy Sosa's doing?
They have the
He's doing the Michael Jackson.
What is the story with that?
he's pretty now.
Yeah. Look at this. Look at Sammy Sosa, Joel. Look at him.
Holy shit.
And he swears he's not bleaching his skin.
But look who he's standing next to.
I don't know who he's standing next to.
An incredibly hot girl.
And she looks confused as shit in that picture.
That's Sammy Sosa also, Joel.
Yeah,
that's the next.
That was you're looking at the old Sammy Sosa. The hot girl's the new one. That's after
that hot chick. That's Mark McGuire. That's a whole different story.
I would never say that to his face.
Oh Jesus, no!
You get steroid punched.
That is frightening. What's going on? What's going on there?
You know, it's just age and a lot of money. You just kind of go nuts.
Sure.
I think you have to. I think that's part of the process. I think if you have too much money. Well, too much time on your hand, you just go crazy.
Yeah, what do you do to entertain yourself when you have everything in the world at your fingertips? You got to get into some freaky shit.
Dude, as long as he goes that route and not like the Steve McNair route where he ends up dating psycho girls that fucking murder him, you know? It sucks.
Way to kill the mood of the podcast.
Yeah, no shit. Oh, I'm sorry. Are you guys really sad about Steve McNair dying?
There's a big Steve McNair fan group here.
Joel's disillusioned with baseball. I got disillusioned with pro football years ago because I grew up as a Houston Oilers fan, which is a lot like being a French Army fan. And then, as far as I know, the Houston Oilers are the only franchise in the history of professional sports to be bought and then completely dissolved, and they're gone. Like, that didn't happen to the Cleveland Browns. They even made steps to make sure that didn't happen to the Sonics when they moved to Oklahoma.
Yep.
You know? you know, that,
Oklahoma.
But I mean, you know, football has a salary cap, right?
I don't care. I don't watch pro football anymore. I couldn't care less about pro football.
Why would you care about pro football when you've got the national championship of UT and Alabama coming up in a couple months?
How awesome is that going to be?
It's going to be great. I'm excited.
It's going to make for some interesting podcast. We're finally going to have sports talk on the podcast.
I know. It's going to be really fun.
You think the Bama's going to make it by Florida?
I hope so. I don't know. We'll see. Florida beat us last year.
I'd like to see a Bama UT national championship.
And this doesn't mean much to you guys, but I'm actually more worried about Auburn than Florida.
No, that makes sense.
The final game of the season.
It's a rivalry game, right?
It is the rivalry game. Yeah. We beat LSU. If we could beat LSU, I think we could probably beat Florida.
Well, I just hope UT can somehow get through the rest of its schedule without slipping to number 10.
Nah, we can't.
On the rankings. Well, somehow.
Well, there is A&M still.
Yeah, I don't get it. I mean, you guys whipped the shit out of Central Florida, right?
Yeah, right.
Why didn't that count?
What a killer schedule Texas has this year.
Well, I mean, we did go against three teams that were in the top 25, right? I mean, Oklahoma State was number 14 when we
to be fair, there have been 70 teams in the top 25 this year.
That's a good point. And Oklahoma's not even in the top 25 now, and that was our biggest game of the year. I mean, it's one of those things where at the time they were overrated.
At the time they had Bradford in, and then we hit Bradford, and then Bradford went out of the game, and then...
Bradford being their quarterback, we had him back. They had him back. I mean, he literally was in after being out for several games, and we took him out in the first two plays of the game.
If Bradford's in their lineup, they're higher ranked than they are than if he's not.
Yeah, well, they might have won some more games, including probably the Texas game, honestly. I mean, that was a pretty close game.
It's true.
Oh, snap.
I mean, you know, let's be honest. That's good. Texas schedule this year sucks. I'm a Texas fan. It sucks. I don't want to watch the team play University of Central Florida. No offense if you're an Oregon woman that goes to University of Central Florida. I don't want to see that.
I agree with you completely.
I want to see us play Ohio State.
I agree with you completely, but it's not enough for us to, get unranked out of the top three.
We're not unranked out of the top three. Who's going to unrank us? TCU? Not going to happen. Iowa? Boo-hoo. Not going to happen.
You guys are number two in the AP still, I think, right?
Yeah.
Ahead of Alabama.
Great. So we're going to win the Sports Writers Championship.
Well, that's a third of the BCS ranking.
Well, it's enough to get you to the national championship to play a good team.
Yeah.
It will be.
I mean, as long as you guys stay undefeated, you know you're playing either Florida or Alabama.
That's going to be the national championship. That's going to be the story at the end of the day, is that Texas will essentially be rewarded for having this horrible patsy schedule. Now, granted, we can't affect the conference that we're in. A&M should be better. Oklahoma should be better. Nebraska and Colorado should be better. They're just not.
What the fuck happened in Nebraska? They totally dissolved. They were a powerhouse for a while, and then
they're
gone.
Same with University of Miami. Remember? I mean, they went 4 years. They went 4 seasons without being beaten.
You're talking about Miami, Florida?
Yeah.
Yeah, dude. Fucking Miami.
Hurricanes, right?
The last national championship Alabama won was against Miami in the Sugar Bowl, 92 or 93.
I mean, that team, to me...
They were unstoppable
back in the early
90s.
Yeah.
Notre Dame just lost to Navy this last week.
Navy's going to a bowl. They got the first bowl bid, I think, right?
Man,
is that right?
I hate Notre Dame. I hate Notre Dame.
Do you?
God, dude. It's how do you have a mediocre team and yet you have, a contract with NBC?
I hate that NBC, has a deal with them. It's like, oh, awesome. I get to watch mediocre football every Saturday on NBC.
They signed that contract decades ago. I mean, they signed that early 90s, I think. And it was a bad move on NBC's part. They locked up the rights to Notre Dame football. They thought, well, this team's so great right now, they got to be great forever.
Who Brandon Tartikoff probably made that call, right? It's who makes that call?
I don't know. Probably a Notre Dame alum, honestly.
Yeah.
A good call.
Wants to see his team play.
Did you go on Jenga Jam last night?
No, I didn't go on, but I was attending Jenga Jam while they talked about RVBTO, the Red versus Blue fan event that takes place every year in Toronto, and they're already laying the groundwork for the next one, which will be, I think, sometime in July of next year.
Anything interesting come out of it?
I don't know. I mean, I know a lot about RVBTO already, but I think a lot more people got to learn about it.
They sound super organized, which is great.
I was listening to it this morning before we started our podcast. Obo Crazy had a news item about, I guess, some Russian coach for a Counter-Strike team, I guess obviously in Russia, was trying to train his players to concentrate on the game, so he hired strippers.
Oh, I saw that on...
It was on Destructoid.
I saw the images on Destructoid.
Yeah, he hired strippers to dance around and try to distract the players away from their game.
I heard Lawrence Taylor used to do stuff like that to the opposition or whatever. It would send them hookers in the middle of the night.
Lawrence Taylor just got arrested the other day.
What a shock. For what?
He got in a car accident and was a suspected DUI.
I think being Lawrence Taylor is a jailable offense, isn't it? Just walking around as LT.
I wonder if he still has enough like residual drugs in his system to where he tests positive.
He
to this
is
day.
One of the most entertaining figures in the history of sports, though. You gotta love Lawrence Taylor.
He was great in Tecmo Bowl.
Yeah, he was.
He was great in Tecmo Bowl.
I loved him.
Bernie has, awesome. Bernie has a great Lawrence Taylor story about the day he took out
Joe Theismann. Now, I don't know if the story is true, but this is a story I always heard about Joe Theismann. It was probably the most horrific injury
I don't
of
like
modern
to think
sports.
About it.
I remember watching it when it happened.
It must have been when they just invented replay and were using it on a regular basis or multi-camera angles. They showed essentially both bones in this guy's calf.
Joe Theismann.
He was tackled by Lawrence Taylor, and you just got to watch his leg crumple inside of his uniform.
Bend a really wrong way.
Yeah, and they showed it from every angle over and over and over again. They were really just horrific about it. And Lawrence Taylor was kneeling next to him and just...
Because Lawrence Taylor did it.
Yeah, because Lawrence Taylor did it, sacked him and did it. And he's there crying, and Joe Theismann apparently was just yelling. He's screaming, "You can't keep me out of this game! I'll be back! And Lawrence Taylor was, you know, really demure. It's apparently saying, "Oh man, I'm so sorry, I hope you'll be better, I'm praying for you," all this stuff. And then Joe Theismann's getting on the stretcher, and he's like, I'll be back! And apparently, I guess Lawrence Taylor just reached his limit of shit-talking for Joe Theismann, and Joe Theismann goes, "I'll be back!" And Lawrence Taylor said, "Not today, you won't." As he's being stretchered away to the ambulance.
That's a horrible video.
That's funny, too, because that might be the worst football injury I've ever seen. I mean, that was a potent. I mean, when you see a leg break.
I don't know. Did you see that Pop Warner video the other day?
Oh, the kid getting leveled?
That was fucked up.
Oh, when they hit head-to-head?
I'm so glad I have a daughter.
Man.
Those are bad coaches. Both those kids lowered their heads like battering rams and in a drill.
Yeah.
And hit each other.
I did not see that.
No, yeah, it's like terrible. Two, like, 6 or 7 year old kids. And then,
one of the dads must have posted that online. Like, it's a good hit.
Yeah. That's really sad.
There was something that happened this weekend with a college football player where he dove into the end zone and landed on his head. And the moment he comes out of it, it's like his body is like frozen almost. It's like his limbs just go like...
Does he go like knocked out boxer where he's like still trying to punch on the ground?
Kind of. And it's just so disturbing to see that, you know?
I saw a dude that he leapt to go in the end zone. Did we talk about Reggie Bush flying 6 yards?
Fuck, dude. That was
in mid-stride?
Awesome. Yeah.
No, did we talk about that?
I don't think we talked about it. But not only did he do it, he did it like he was like he was just fucking skipping. He was like
big step. Yeah, I'm just saying a big step from the 6 yard line.
It's like, it looks like a water puddle. I'll just hop over that.
Yeah, he scored a touchdown.
6 yard water puddle.
Who were they playing? It was the Saints versus... I think there's somebody in the white helmet, but I can't think of who. I don't think it was the Cardinals. Anyway, yeah, it was an amazing, amazing play.
This has got to be the most macho podcast in the history of
the
world.
Here we go, baby. We're talking about sports finally. I saw a hit that happened. I saw the replay of it where a guy went to dive into the end zone. And we've all seen that play where the Miami Dolphin guy gets hit and he does the helicopter.
Yeah. Right, uh-huh.
Well, this was a weird set of circumstances. And you see the whole thing get set up where he gets hit in his legs and he jumps as he gets hit in his legs. So he kind of tilts to the right, and then some other linebacker just comes up and hits him. I'm not kidding. He hit him 12 feet up into the air.
Really?
It was just, you wonder why, and when you see it, you're like, how come this doesn't happen more often? The guy's got to launch straight up in the air, because three people hit him in a row, and it just, all that force, he ends up 12 feet in the air, and he landed flat on his back in the end zone, and he was out after it happened. It was pretty crazy.
Wow.
You're going to have a lot of fun link dumping this week, guys.
Yeah, I'll have to find all these videos. Jesus.
Matt needs to incorporate that into the gameplay.
But the craziest injury that I've ever heard of, though, in sports is still the guy, and I don't know who it was. He was, I want to say he was a lineman, and he was blinded by the ref.
Oh, right.
The ref threw the flag, it came down into his helmet, and the weight hit him in the eye
I remember watching that game when it happened. Like, the lineman grabs a flag and like throws it on the ground and like goes after the ref. And at the time, you're thinking, "Geez, what an asshole! Why is he going after the ref?" And then like 2 years later, you know, you read the story. You picked up the story about how he's in his 7th eye surgery and his career is over, and just like it really messed him up.
It's like that hockey player who got his fucking throat slit by a skate.
That was horrible.
That was fucked up. One of the craziest ones I'd ever seen. The sports injury was when Moises Alou broke his ankle. Do you remember that? That was like in 94 or so.
I don't remember Moises Alou broke his ankle.
Yeah, he was like running. I think he was in the outfield. And he was running to catch a fly ball, and his foot got caught in the turf, and he fell down, and his ankle was like, instead of being like this, was like this and up. His toe was pointing this way.
Just to demonstrate what Gus is doing, he's saying like this, and he's showing a normal foot, and like this, he's showing something that's horrific.
I'll find the video, and you can see it.
Joel, you might remember this. Who was the pitcher in the mid-90s who was pitching a game and threw a ball so hard he broke his arm mid-throw, and they found out he broke it because he had cancer in the arm? Do you remember that?
I remember that guy, and then he healed and made a comeback. And then they won the pennant to go to the World Series, yeah. And he re-broke his arm in the celebration.
Yeah.
How sad is that, dude?
Yeah, I remember that. There's no way I remember the name, but I totally remember
that
story.
He was a pretty decent pitcher back then, too. I can't remember who it was.
Yeah.
I guess we'll find out in the link dump.
I remember Abbott, the guy that had one, who was a pitcher that had
Jeff
one.
Jeff Abbott?
Yeah. No, it was Jim Abbott, wasn't it?
Was it Jim Abbott?
The worst sports injuries, by far, have got to be the weightlifting accidents. when you see weightlifting accidents, those are always the worst. Like, seeing arms bend backwards and, like, those are the worst.
You know what's really odd about this, too, is that class of injury is just horrifying and you want to look away. Skateboarding accidents, always funny.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what they do.
They're always nut shots, right?
Yeah. Or they break their arm and you're like, dumbass. it doesn't matter.
Well, it's because you're like, if you jump off a roof on a skateboard, you deserve to break something. And I'm a skater, agree with that. Like, you stand on a skateboard, you recognize that what you're about to do is stupid, and when you do something stupid, you just have to deal with the consequences.
It's one of those moments where you look back, where all of a sudden you, like, dissolve yourself from the human race, and it's like, what are these people are putting themselves on a board with wheels and then trying to jump off a 20?
Before I was 25, I had 3 concussions from skateboarding. And it's like, I never once felt like I got robbed or it was a bad deal. I knew it.
I did all that stuff, too, as a kid. I was, like, a freestyle bike guy or whatever, and this is ridiculous. Like, I was sponsored. You can't break a toe, but I fractured all of my toes. What? I broke a growth plate in my arm. I did so much damage to myself. It was unbelievable.
Was this back when the bikes had one big wheel and one little wheel? Was that the kind of bike you had?
It's true. I had a really long mustache.
Did you sponsor have a cute curly mustache?
We'd rescue the girls from the railroad.
Fucked up injuries like that. My cousin used to be really into motocross, and he would do a lot of amateur motocross racing. And this is one of the worst. I didn't see it, but one of the worst like breaks I've ever heard of. He broke the bridge of his foot right here.
What?
Yeah,
the
top of his foot across like you can't see it, but I'm motioning about 3 inches up from the toes, just like right across the top. Snapping.
Man,
in half. How fucked up is that? It's sad.
You know, we were talking about this the other day, and Jeff didn't know. Did you guys know that I was in a diving accident?
No, I didn't know.
I didn't know. You told me the story. I heard you tell it the other day. I'd never heard it before,
though. A diving accident?
Well, who was it that was in here? It was Brandon.
Yeah.
Brandon sent me a link to... It was just like any video you see online.
Don't link this.
Do not link this. And it was just guys like jumping off a seawall into the water. And it's just a normal day. And then one dude slips and he falls about 30 feet onto cement on his face and dies. And it's like... the video you never see online. You always see the guys like, oh, you know, and it's like, you okay? He's like, yeah, that was fucked up. You're like, how the hell did that guy live? This is a guy who did not.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I'm a little confused. A diver who
jumping off a wall.
He was diving off a wall, seawall, and had to clear sidewalk below them. He did not clear the sidewalk. And it was, yeah, so he died. And I can't look at stuff like that or even watch any kind of like cliff diving, like where a girl jumps off and gets knocked out or hurts her butt or something like that. Because I was in a diving accident. It's like when I look back on it, I just cringe with horror at how close I came to dying. Because we were at a party. I was 17. I was in high school. I was drunk. And we were at one of these subdivisions that had like a man-made lake in the middle. And we all jumped in the water, and then I jumped out, and then a bunch more people jumped in. Like, this is where the party's going now, is down in the water. And so I went to jump back in, but everybody was where I jumped before. So I went to jump to the left, and I don't know why. I mean, I'm just, a more cautious person. I remember thinking somewhere in the back of my head, don't dive in because you don't know what you're diving into. I jumped in, and I landed on an 8-foot-wide drainage pipe that was, like, an inch under the water. They said it looked like – everybody said it looked like I bounced off the water, and I broke my leg doing it because I jumped down about 3 or 4 feet, but it
that sucks.
You know, when you go to make that last step off the stair and you realize there's no other step, imagine doing that from 6 feet high.
Did you cry?
No, I was like, what the fuck happened?
That sucks.
And I broke my left leg and I kind of knew something was fucked up. I thought I had sprained it. I actually drove a standard, like a clutch car home that day. And believe it or not, the pressure of the constant pressure of the clutch on my foot actually felt better. But the next day I woke up and my leg was huge and I couldn't move my foot. And
So. It's amazing anyone survives, you know, the age of like 11 to 19.
It's crazy. Yeah. You know, similarly, we found out when Bernie was telling me this, it reminded me when I got stationed when I was in the Army, when I was 18, I got stationed at Fort Hood, which is just about an hour north of Austin, hour and a half north of Austin. I took the bunk. Like, I got assigned the room of a guy who 3 weeks later had died in a diving accident like that, like in Dalton Lake. Which is up in, you know, about an hour and a half from here. And, like, I moved into some dead guy's room. It was really weird and creepy.
I remember being in the Boy Scouts, like, at summer camp or whatever. And, like, while I was there, you know, there was this lake that everyone would go to. And sure enough, some guy dived in. And it's, like, 4 feet of water. Dived in. Hit his head.
Dove.
Thank you so much, Jeff. You're always there for me. And no one was around. He was unconscious. And he was, like, laying... you know, face down in the water for a couple of minutes, and someone, you know, saw, oh, the body, and they came and rushed him, you know, and the guy was, he was paralyzed from, like, the neck down for the rest of his life, you know, and it's just, God, it's horrible.
That and motorcycles, number one cause of paralysis.
So the moral of this podcast is to never play sports and never dive into anything.
And the thing that I always say, always want to point out, never, ever, ever light yourself on fire.
Safety first, kids.
I see so many videos of kids doing dopey thing where they're going to light their arm on fire or they're going to blow fire. You're going to die. You're going to burn to death.
I'm going to combine both your stories about fire and about you moving into the dead guy's room. The room I moved into when I first got to college was the room... The previous guy who lived in my room had burned down the pub at my college.
Is that true, really?
Yeah. He got convicted of arson and had to go to prison because he burned down the
Did you get to
bar.
Have, like, all A's that semester?
Wow, that's pretty Speaking of, crazy. All right, I'll go one up on that. I had to sit next to a kid in math class in seventh grade when I moved to New Orleans, or the outskirts of New Orleans, which is a fucked up place to live. Sketchy, sketchy dudes. And the kid I sat next to had just gotten out of juvie after being expelled from the school that he burned down. I had to sit next to this kid. It was fucking terrifying.
The kid, there was someone who sat two seats behind me in my ninth grade history class who went to prison 3 years later for murdering someone.
What?
Wow.
He was a big dude. I was like,
The lighting yourself on fire thing is something that's really close to home for me, too, because I have a history of almost lighting myself on fire and looking back across the years going, oh, my God, I can't believe how close I came to dying there.
Didn't your mom bust you making napalm once?
That's what I was about to say. I was about 14, and when, you know, my friend down the street.
Our generation, like, discovering the internet, for our generation, it was discovering the anarchist cookbook.
The anarchist, pretty much, right. That's why you got online. Like, now you kids get online to download porn. We got online to download the anarchist cookbook, which was a text file of all these crazy things you could make with household products. And my friend down the street had an Atari 400 computer, or maybe it was an Atari 800, with a 300 baud modem. You would transfer a picture in about 20 minutes.
Nice.
You know, a 100K picture if such a thing existed. And we got the Anarchist Cookbook, and it was how you could make napalm with... I don't even want to say it, but because I wouldn't... Mm-hmm. Don't attempt to do this.
I'm going to do a quick disclaimer, if this is okay. You shouldn't look for this anymore, because as time's gone on, people have created modified versions of this file with stuff in there that's wrong and that will kill you.
Really?
Yeah. So, like, the file that exists now is not the same file we saw back then.
So you'll mix two chemicals and you'll die of
like
chlorine
gas. Right. Yeah. So, I mean, please do not look
just,
for this thing.
Anyway. Just stay at home and don't do anything.
Click on the link in the link dump that Gus is going to put up.
Kids, what we're saying is, watch porn.
Yeah.
It's way
just
cooler.
Really, play the guitar and watch porn. That's it.
Jack off, have fun.
It's like what you said earlier. It's like we're getting worse because we're getting conditioned where all you see is videos on the internet of like something going horribly wrong, but oh, guess what? I survived. You know, and it's like, no. You know,
it's amazing amount of people get hit by cars and survive. But let me finish telling this real quick. What I did was, so one of the steps in this was I had to boil a gallon of gasoline on the stove. Okay, and I was not a dumb, really dumb kid. I mean, clearly I'm dumber than average if I'm boiling gasoline. But I knew we had an electric range, and we didn't have open flames, and that it could make fumes, so I had a fan going and was blowing. And then my parents were gone, so I started boiling about a quarter of a gallon of gasoline in a pot on the stove. I'm serious, boiling it. And my mom comes home, and she said the whole place smelled like a mechanic shop because you're boiling gasoline. And, I ran it out the back door, this pot of gasoline, and put it outside. And she came out. She goes, "What are you doing?" And she was just like crying, like, mortified. Like, what? I don't understand what this is. And I tried to calm her down, explain the science behind it and all this. And my dad, who was a physicist, you know, she said, get home right now. You have to talk to this kid. He's a maniac. So my dad comes home. They sit me at the kitchen table. I tried to explain to him what I was doing and that I didn't think it was dangerous because while it made fumes, there was no open flames and you couldn't ignite the gasoline unless there was an open flame. And my mom's crying and my dad goes, well, technically, he is correct.
So that's definitely like your dad.
Now my dad is in as much trouble as I am. But, I mean, you know, I now know from everything I know about appliances and everything, any one of those appliances in that kitchen could cause a spark.
Yeah.
And I would have just been 98% burned across my whole body
yeah.
in 1 second.
Gas.
The story
like
wouldn't be nearly as funny.
Oh gas is God. The worst thing ever. It reminds me, I was very bored growing up in Alabama, and so I used to huff a lot of gas. And,
really, I could never have told.
Yeah, no, tons. And when I was in the Army,
but your grammar
is impeccable. I hope my mother doesn't listen to this podcast. Anyway, so I was in the Army. I was between schools when I was in journalism school. And they would send us every morning to go out and do details, which would be like, you would just go into this room and they'd go, hey, you're going to cut the grass today. Hey, you're going to move some lumber. You're going to buff a floor. And one day they go, hey, it's winter. This is in Indiana in like November. And they go, hey, it's winter. It's time to empty out all the gas in all of the lawnmowers on this entire base. You can do that by yourself. And they put me in a room with like 30 lawnmowers, and I was responsible for it, siphoning the gas out of it and then into cans for the winter. And I was like, best day of my life. So I started huffing gas, and I got so high and so fucked up, I threw up all over myself and passed out, and they had to rush me to the hospital. And I was
Jesus.
Like, I guess I just got overcome by fumes. To this day, that might be the first time I've ever told that story, but I actually was, like, when they were rushing me to the hospital in the back of a pickup truck, it was actually because I was huffing gas.
You know, it's almost like environmentalism. It's like, forget going green. It's just like, we need to get gasoline out of the hands of everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We just got to take it out of the scenario.
I wonder if one day we'll say, like, do you remember we had to stop and fill our cars with fluid? Like, that won't make any sense to us.
No,
at
I mean,
all.
When yeah. you think about it, it's like, when you think about it, let me get this straight. We're going to have these machines that have highly flammable tanks, and we're going to put it a couple feet away from sparks.
Yeah,
and then on every street corner, we're going to have giant tanks of the same highly flammable.
Not only that, but the flammable fluid you're putting in your vehicle powers your vehicle because your vehicle's constantly exploding.
Constantly exploding.
Yeah. Yeah, 4 explosions every cycle, if it, you know, an 8-cylinder engine.
Yeah, 4 to 8
yeah.
know, explosions typically.
That Anarchist Cookbook reminds me of how much the world has changed in like the last 15 years or so. Because in my high school, everybody had the Anarchist Cookbook, and we all played around with it and stuff, right? And it reminds me, like, in the 9th grade one time, I got in trouble because I was sitting in the second row, and this kid went up to talk to the teacher. I was in the first row, and the kid went up to talk to my teacher, who I fucking despised. And I pantsed him in front of her, and his dick fell out on her table. And it was like a whole thing, and I had to go to like get some counseling, mildly, and stuff. And I kept it from my parents. I still don't think they know. Anyway, and so the teacher got me in trouble.
This is a great podcast for your mom.
They don't listen to the podcast.
And I from that day on, I was really mad at that teacher. And one day she started saying something to me, and I got pissed. And I was kind of a smartass in high school. And I was like, you know what? I've seen The Terminator, and Michael Bane taught me how to make pipe bombs, and I have the Anarchist Cookbook. I can blow your... And I said, I know what your car looks like, and I know where you live. I can follow you home and blow your house up one day. And she goes, go sit in the back of the room. If you did that today, like threatened to blow a teacher up with a pipe bomb, you'd be in jail for the rest of your life.
You'd be in Gitmo.
Yeah, you'd be in Gitmo.
That's fucking terrorism.
In, like, 1989, not a big deal.
No, dude, that's...
Now you hear kids wearing, like... Kids will wear, like, Scottish kilts to school with, like, ceremonial knives and the belt buckle that are, like, historically accurate, and they get like, expelled. I threatened to blow a teacher in her car up, and then nothing happened.
That's pretty freaking crazy, Jeff. I mean, that's a really crazy story. I would not have been able to say that to anybody at any point.
Well, don't ever piss me off.
It's funny.
That's pretty wacky.
Yeah, you don't grab me as that guy at all, which is just goes back
to
being,
I was being a smart ass. I don't think she took me seriously.
You know what happened to me when I was a kid?
Jeff's like that. Jeff's been like that his whole life, by the way. Anyway, go ahead.
I went to a high
been
school
like
in D.C.
Maniac.
And when I was at the high school, a gunman came to my high school and held up the principal. And I can't remember this day if anyone died, but it happened at my high school.
Dude, yeah.
And at Lake Braddock in Washington, D.C., and I remember, like, the FBI came and hordes of police came. This school was huge. It was from 7th to 12th grade, so it was a huge school, so it had all sections off. And I remember, like, the school went into lockdown, and, like, the different classrooms were, like, locked down. And, like, cops would come, and, like, certain classes were able to like get out of the school, and like the cops would escort you in line. You get out of school, and then certain people were like trapped there till like 10 at night or whatever.
Maybe I just went to a shitty school, because when I was in the 11th grade, we had a shootout and a kid got shot in the leg in first period in the hallway, and they didn't even I didn't get to go home. They didn't even stop classes.
Remember, it was thing, a normal like day. At the time, like it happened at the time these things happened, but there was no CNN.
Yeah, I guess right. That's true. Yeah,
like, do you remember bomb threats? There's a thing somebody had a test, they call in a bomb threat to the school.
Yeah.
Like, that was a normal thing. If you called it a bomb threat to a school today, that would be black helicopters swarming. Yeah.
Whenever there was a bomb threat at my high school, like, we'd walk out, and then we'd walk, like, literally, like, you know, there's, like, a driveway where you, like, I guess parents could come and drop off their kids, and we'd, like, walk to the other side of the driveway, like, 30 feet from the school. And I was like, this is the stupidest thing ever.
And everybody knew it was stupid.
Yeah, and I walked over to the principal, and I was like, you know, if there really was a bomb in there, stepping 30 feet away from the building's not going to do anything for us.
Yeah. It's just an exercise in liability, essentially.
Yeah.
That reminds me of another time in the 10th grade. I sat next to this girl in math class, and she got called to the principal's office, and I was like, oh, you fucking trouble. And she came back 10 minutes later, and I go, what was it? And she goes, my dad makes me carry a gun, and I put it on the floorboard of my car, and I guess one of the teachers saw it, and I had to explain it.
Yeah, that happened in my school.
I had to explain
that happened
it.
In
that
my
was
high school.
She didn't have to, like, remove the gun or anything. She just had to explain why there was a gun in her car.
In the parking lot of the school.
In the parking lot of the school.
It's,
right.
It's funny because we say these stories, and at the time that they happened, like, I remember the time that happened, like the school invasion or whatever, to me and to everyone around me, this is fantastic. This is awesome. It's a holiday. We're going to have a good time. Something interesting. Good times.
Our principal could be shot.
Who holds
whatever.
Up a principal?
It's celebration, you know? Whatever. Who
That's
cares?
Where the big bucks are.
It's all good times, right? But now you guys are parents.
Yeah.
And now you got to go through the same cycle again, except for the other side.
Yeah, I know.
If there was a gunman at my kid's school, I would be...
My kid's 4 and she's already threatening to break my wife's nose. Yeah, I'm in for bad times.
Yeah, even I grew up like in a small town, and like a kid showed up once with a gun and tried to shoot someone else, and they fought, and the gun went off and like shot a hole in the ceiling, and it was like, all right, she got expelled. But
back to class.
Anyway, it was like there's two female students. She got expelled, but other
two
than
female
that,
students.
Yeah, it was like, all you right, know, everyone go back to class.
I mean, honestly, probably stuff like that still happens to this day.
I guess.
You know, and the person gets expelled, and we just don't hear about it because nothing came of it.
We just hear about the ridiculous stuff.
But Jeff, I mean, you were genuinely, as a kid, you were a maniac. Because you were, how old were you when, was it elementary school, when your mom, his mom, no, this is Jeff's in elementary school, so think about this.
I was like third grade,
8 years old. His mom's friend came to pick him up because his mom had to work late because she's a nice working lady. So
she's a dental assistant.
Her friend agreed to come pick up young Jeff. So this woman that Jeff sees every day shows up and says, oh, I'm so-and-so's friend. I'm here to pick up Jeff today. The teacher says, okay, Jeff, you know her, right? And Jeff goes, I've never seen her before in my life. This lady's trying to kidnap me. And the friend is like, okay, haha, Jeff, come on, really, tell her who I am, that you know me. And Jeff says, I really don't know. I'm kind of scared by all everything that's happening right now.
It got worse, because eventually they got me to agree that I knew her, but then I said that the reason I'd lied was because she touched me.
Oh, really? God damn, man. What's wrong with you?
Oh,
Jeez.
My God.
Third grade.
She's my mom's best friend.
Oh, my God.
So is that an investigation on this lady, I assume?
No, I had to admit
I've never
that
heard that part of the story.
I had to admit that I made it up. My mom reminded me of the touching part. I didn't remember that. Yeah.
Wow.
Dude, I just...
Wow.
Come on. You guys never did stuff like that when you were a kid?
No,
just to have
Jesus.
Fun? You guys never tried to fuck with adults?
No, I never fucked with adults as a kid. Never.
Oh, see, I didn't have any respect for adults growing up.
I feel like I did, but I never did anything like that.
Yeah.
God.
Dude, that's awesome. Yeah, and now your daughter's the same way.
I showed you guys this thing that I found sitting on the counter at a convenience store that was a dollar. And it was the mugshots.
Oh, right.
It was all the mugshots taken in Austin over the course of the last week. And everybody's name and what they were charged with.
Mm-hmm. And a picture.
And like funny little quips about them. And
it was a whole thing. It was like 30 pages, right?
And we see this online. A good example would be like the Smoking Gun does their weekly mugshot archive that they put up.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, that's taking public information and using that for very nefarious purposes, in my opinion, especially if you're making money off of it. Because everyone came here looking at it, like, wow, this guy was busted for DWI. Wow, look at this girl, public intoxication. I wish I'd have run into her when she was drunk out in public because she's hot. And I said, I have to point out, everyone you're looking at is innocent. Because they haven't been charged with anything.
No one would perceive it that way.
No way.
Everyone who will read that magazine, everyone who will look at every single one of the people, that's a guilty person.
The mugshot is the new scarlet letter.
Yeah.
And the moment somebody gets busted for something and they take a mugshot, the news agencies can put it up wherever. You can put it on the cover of a magazine, the mugshot, and you look like a criminal. It's public record.
It is absolutely true. It's like we're so weirdly culturally conditioned.
A couple of years ago, our friend got arrested. I'm not going to say why. But she got arrested, and the next morning, Gus was like, I'll be back. And he drove up to the town that she got arrested in to get her mugshot, and he did.
Yep. I'd never gone about the process before. I was like,
I just wanted to see what it was like.
Yeah, I was like, I want to get a mugshot.
Wait.
And they were like, do you know what the case number is? I was like, no, I know the person's name. And they're like, all right, sit here. And then I sat down, and then 5 minutes later, they're like, all right, here you go.
Why? You didn't do that.
Why not?
Because you just wanted to
picture. We just wanted it because we thought it'd be funny in a funny photo and we could make fun of her with it.
I wanted it to be her employee photo at the place we used to work at.
Wow, that is funny.
You know, the smart thing to do was not to be hide what she did or what she was arrested for, but to hide her name. That might have been a better idea.
I got your email yesterday regarding Child's Play.
What's going on with Child's Play?
Oh, yeah. We're trying to figure out who's going to go and who wants to go to the charity dinner. Do you want to go?
Maybe it depends on what it is.
It's in Seattle at December 8th, I think, or thereabouts.
Very fun time.
Cool.
I wore a tux when I went.
Nice.
Yeah, we tried to wear red and blue tuxes that 1 year, right? Is that what we did?
Yeah, they didn't have actual red and blue tuxes, so we wore tuxes that had red and blue, I don't know.
Cummerbunds or something?
Cummerbunds, yeah.
Wow, Child's Play is already up to $250,000 this year.
No, that's fast.
That's a juggernaut.
That's pretty cool.
Of help.
Let me ask you a question. When I'm reading a blog and it says find out more information after the jump, what the fuck is the jump?
It's like where it says continue or
there's a read block, more. An ad or something in there?
Yeah, sometimes.
I think that's come to mean just something entirely different because people will say read about it after the jump and then the next paragraph has the information.
I
think
I can answer that if you'd like.
Oh, please.
The jump is a newspaper term. So, when you read an article above the fold on the front page of a newspaper, you're only going to read the first 4 or 5 paragraphs, and then you jump to page 6. It'll say, continued on page 6. That's called a jump.
That's right.
And so people are just using that terminology for the internet when you get, an abbreviated news post, and then you have to click on it to go to the next page.
Yeah, I always thought it was, when there's, an abbreviated news post on the front page, and you click, read more, and it loads, the page with the whole story.
Yeah, that's the jump. It's newspaper terminology. Mm.
But it seems like a lot of people use it, how Bernie's saying, how they'll insert an advertisement or something else, and then after the jump means after the ad.
But then there won't be an ad sometimes. Right. It's just, maybe I'm seeing an archived version of it.
They double space, and then there's the rest of the article.
It's like a dramatic pause before you find out that there's going to be a patch for Warcraft.
Do you know what the budget for Avatar is, Joel?
No, what is it?
No, wait, if you had to guess.
What did you guess? Knowing that Titanic came out, it was $200 million, most expensive film of all time when it came out. This is 15 years later, whatever.
I was going to say 160 million, but now maybe that's low.
Oh my god,
it's estimated to be $500 million.
$500 million.
That seems impossible to me.
But that number, they're rolling global marketing into that number as well.
Well, they should. I mean,
yeah, which they did for Titanic too.
$100 million.
Yep.
It seems like you should just. I mean, I feel like I should go to the theater and just have an orgasm while watching.
The second highest grossing film of all time is The Dark Knight. It made $520 million.
It would barely have made money.
If James Cameron just – Avatar is the second highest grossing film of all time, it would clear 4% profit or something.
They're also figuring in money that Cameron's put in out of pocket and all the money that's actually being used to make – they say that the official budget will probably turn out to be $260 million.
It's not a real budget though.
Yeah, but
– it's a big pocket. Yeah. I mean, if you can make it that much of a difference. Although, I gotta say, it'd be pretty cool to have the number one and number two highest grossing movie.
It'd be pretty fucking cool.
Back to back.
The trailer's tremendous. So, we'll see.
$500 million buys you effects that I've seen. That's... I mean, the Avatar guy creatures don't look good to me.
I think you'll be surprised when you see it in the film. In the big screen.
I hate saying this, but I'm really excited to see that movie on the IMAX in 3D.
Yeah, I am too.
I know that's so gimmicky, and I know I hate 3D.
No, I mean, I'm excited to see anything on IMAX, just because it's it should look cool with the effects or whatever, but I'm the story.
Really? Did you see the latest trailer that kind of explains the story? I thought it was awesome. It came out 2 weeks ago.
Maybe I haven't.
Ugh.
Pretty cool. Yeah, we talked about it last week.
Yeah, we talked about it last week. Yeah. It might have been Jack in here last week.
Yeah, it was Jack in here last week.
It's a very cool trailer. Very, very cool. And you get a sense of what the movie's about, and it seems really interesting.
I found a really cool thing online. We're talking about fantastical nutty stuff. I found a site called TheBeatlesNeverBrokeUp.com, and it's presented as a story of a guy who is walking his dog in the desert, and something happens, and he has an accident, and he hits his head, and when he wakes up, he's somewhere else. What he's saying is an alternate dimension.
Okay.
He was in the same place, but in a different dimension, and he went in and talked with somebody. It was an alternate reality, and the guy that he spoke with, they determined that he was from a different timeline as the guy that he was talking to. And in the timeline where he was, the Beatles had never broken up, and that was a big deal. And this guy had mixtapes, because they hadn't had CDs either, for whatever reason. And so he had this mixtape that he had made from recording Beatles songs, and I guess recording them off the radio. And then the guy came back to his own timeline, but had the tape in his hand, and he has new recordings from the Beatles that he has now posted online. Does that make sense?
What? That's so...
That's the craziest thing I've ever
convoluted
heard.
And crazy. I know what you're saying.
So can you listen to these recordings?
You can. He posted them all online.
Does it sound...
Let's...
This is from Everyday Chemistry by the Beatles.
I want to hear audio.
Yeah, I want to hear...
Presumably it's from an 80s album.
It sounds what you think it would sound like, doesn't it?
It does sound like what you'd think it would sound like.
How did he do that?
Nobody knows, really.
He was in the desert, and he hit his head.
Is he still purporting that this is true?
Yes, that he's sticking to his story, that this is how he got these songs.
I didn't mute my phone, I'm sorry. It's my wife.
I just thought it was really interesting.
That's interesting.
That's some John Titor shit right there.
Yeah,
that's
exactly right.
Yeah, that's like pretty cool. Titor. You have to send me a link to that, or I'll check the link.
And he's got 10 songs that are all linked there from the mixtape that
and
he brought
did
back.
He bring anything else back? Other
he
than
just
the
he had it with him or something. I'll admit the story is really, really, really long, and I just kind of skimmed it and then started listening to the songs. And it was linked from another blog that I got it. So I think
I'd heard about that. Seems like a cool idea.
That's pretty fucking cool.
The best thing about the internet to me is crazy weird crap that is like X-Files crap that comes out of nowhere that's this crap. This is the best thing about the internet to me.
Well, it's just creativity, right? Like it's like you have instant access to the collective creativity of every single person that has a computer, and that's pretty cool.
To me, the new entertainment is, this is not a story. This is like, we're just going to throw this on you, and you're going to consume it, and it's like some sort of weird thing.
Sure.
It's almost like, what was the movie about the kids who go out into the
Star
forest?
Trek.
Kids who go out into the forest?
Where the Wild Things Are.
Blair Witch Project?
Blair Witch Project, thank you. Like, that, how they presented that for the first... That's got to be the new way to do stuff.
You know, those guys are coming back now and talking about, probably because of Paranormal Activity... They're talking about coming back and making a sequel to The Blair Witch.
There already was a sequel.
The quote-unquote true sequel.
But yeah, they didn't. Oh, it was a studio made it. They didn't make it.
But that's the thing. You shouldn't tell us you're going to do that. You should just make a weird thing and throw it out
there. I mean, that was the coolest thing about The Blair Witch Project is that we found it was online before anyone knew that it was a movie. And there was that moment where we didn't really... I mean, obviously it was a movie.
That's the thing. If you can get people to buy into the premise before they've actually entered the theater or whatever, you've won.
They were seriously promoting it as if it was found footage.
Yes.
Right. That's the way to do it.
They put it out there. They leaked it out there. And, like, we watched it 3 or 4 times, you and I, Gus, before we knew for sure that it was a movie.
Mm-hmm.
And it was awesome.
Yeah, and I bet like,
it was 10 times scarier because of that.
I bet, right? I bet it was, like, that sort of event is unequaled.
Yeah.
But maybe I'm wrong. To me, when I'm on that level and I'm watching something in that way, I can't think of anything that competes with it.
No, absolutely not.
It was pretty cool.
It was very cool.
Pretty cool. And the weird thing about that one to me was I also remember everyone pirated that movie and watched it. It was on monitors at work at the call center, and I kept trying to tell people to turn it off. And everyone had seen it, but they still lined up around the block to see it when it came out in theaters.
Yeah.
Yep.
That was pretty interesting to me.
Jeff and I saw it opening day at the Adobe, and the line, like you said, was out and around the block. It's crazy.
Whatever happened to those people, like Heather Donahue? I mean, were they ever in anything else after that?
I don't know. I remember... I remember like Heather Donahue being on Leno talking about like her career and things that were coming up, but I don't know if they ever really went anywhere. We should look that up. We should link them to that.
What about the guy with the kick that fucking man?
Kicked in the fucking river.
That man was useless.
Did you see the supposed Halo Reach screenshots that were leaked online?
Yeah, they were weird looking. I don't know.
So what do you mean weird?
I don't know. Like the first level to me was like all green and blue and it looked like it was in a cemetery or something.
Oh, I think it was like, I think they were taken with a camera.
Yeah, it looks like. Yeah.
It was hard to make anything out of them.
When I first saw those pictures, I was asking myself, I wonder how much of that is just like, I don't know, like they throw up menus or whatever that aren't going to be finalized or just using old Halo 3 things or whatever. But, you know, I don't know.
I got to say, I'm skeptical too. I mean, I the fact that Halo Reach screenshots are leaked 1 week before Modern Warfare 2 comes out, I'm skeptical of that.
I also, like, if I'm the guy that's going to leak Halo screenshots for a game that's not going to come out for, I don't know, what, a year or two or however long it's going to be till that game comes out, I'm not going to put my name on the screenshot. Fucking handwritten. Tom Morello.
Yeah.
I don't know. I can see...
Which is also the name of a guy from Rage Against the Machine, right?
I can see a lot of people doing that, though, because it's like people are so hungry for attention. They're just like, look at me.
I don't know how this would have happened anyway. We've been up to Bungie before, and it seems like security is always real tight.
What did he say? There was a story behind it. Like, he got at an MLG event, he got access to it or some bullshit. I don't know.
That sounds like bullshit to me.
Yeah,
total
I don't
bullshit.
Sounds fishy to me.
I mean, our experience with Bungie, they don't show anything until they're ready to show it.
Yep.
And not a second beforehand.
And not at some fucking, in the back room of some MLG event.
Yeah. I don't know. It's interesting. It's really interesting. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff, too. There was a Left 4 Dead leak trailer, too. The Left 4 Dead 2 one. And I don't know if they've made an official release of that or anything, but you think once something's leaked, they just go, oh, fuck it, let's put out the real one.
The only time I buy a leak is if there's some sort of connection with somebody who works there.
The only time I buy a leak is if there's a lawsuit involved.
There you go.
Hmm? Or well, if there's, like, legal action taken.
This guy putting his name over the top of it like that, I'm actually surprised more people don't do that, because you look at, say, something like the Wolverine thing, the movie that was leaked a month before Wolverine came out, or 2 months before Wolverine came out. Why do that? Why go to all the trouble to get it, encode it, put it out there, take this work away from the people that are working on it, give it away to everybody else, and then there's no reward for it at all. There's absolutely no purpose to do that.
Yeah, nope. But you put obviously you want some kind of accolades, but you put your fucking name on it and you put a bullseye on yourself. Hey, sue me.
Yeah, but
the
whole system doesn't make sense. I don't understand why people do that in general.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense.
You know, it's like lighting yourself on fire. It's like, what's the upside? What is the upside for doing this? I mean, because it's not like all the people who downloaded it are going to come screaming to your defense and help you out when you're in court paying, you know, $80,000 for all your lawyers to defend yourself.
Well, they will defend you on forums. All right.
They'll make a hell of a petition.
Well, here's
the
question. I mean, is this guy going to get sued? Like, will that happen?
I don't know.
No, I think that's what Gus is saying. It's like, okay, where's the lawsuit or the investigation?
Yeah, let's see a legal reaction, then I'll believe it.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, we've never seen it in the past, right? Have we? Have you known of a case where somebody leaked a game and then got sued?
Fuck yeah, dude. Activision just did it. Dude was selling illegal copies of Call of Duty, Modern Warfare 2, on fucking Craigslist. Activision found out who he was and sent the cops to his house and arrested him.
But wait a
minute. Now they're prosecuting
him. But I mean, in terms of leaking, not selling video games.
He was selling the game before it came out.
I don't know what the deal is with leaking, I mean, it's the first thing every video game company makes you do, or at least I've heard they do this, is make you sign these lengthy NDAs, and I'm assuming anyone who comes in contact with the footage would have signed something. Any game. I'm not just talking about Halo Reach or anything like that.
You would absolutely think so.
And
right.
So where is it, right? Where's the other shoe? We have yet to see it.
It's a mystery.
So I think what we're all saying is we hope this guy goes to jail.
It might be up the guy's asshole. They might be kicking him.
Don't think it's real.
Brought it back around.
I don't buy that it's legitimate in any way.
You don't buy the screenshot's real?
No.
I don't think it's a fake screenshot.
Absolutely.
That would explain it. Yeah.
It's like the old screenshots you saw, like dual-wielding swords and stuff like that.
Yep.
I think it's a Photoshop.
And it's done well enough to where it looks like it's taken on a camera.
It's not necessarily that it's done well enough. It's that it's low enough fidelity. It's that camera that's kind of shaky and things are out of focus.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think you're right. I agree with you. Completely.
And who's to say what that game looks like more than a year out from its release? Right. I don't know when it's coming out.
Yeah, like, why even... Like, Borderlands wasn't even a cel-shaded game until, like, 6 months before it came out. And they had to update all their screenshots and stuff. I wouldn't want to see what Reach looks like right now. Because God knows it's going to change 10 times.
Yeah.
Well, I do remember, though, that there was somebody who was a Microsoft employee's kid leaked a video of the alpha multiplayer beta for Halo 3.
That's how people found out about Last Resort.
Yes, and they had that Last Resort firefight. I shouldn't say firefight, that's an actual mode now. But he was playing Slayer on Last Resort and leaked the video, and it had burned on there the employee's name. So the dad got busted, from what I understand, for that whole thing. Or he put his dad in jeopardy of his job, you know? Because he wanted to show his buddies that he was playing Halo 3.
Fucking so dumb.
Kid. It's the next generation of boiling gasoline on the stove.
It is, yeah.
It's like all the excuses we hear on our website. Oh, it wasn't me. It was my brother using my account. You know,
Oh, boo-hoo-ya.
I didn't mean to do it.
This was my kid brother.
It's funny how there's like sort of just like seven general excuses, and then you see those same seven general excuses again and again and
kid
again.
Kid brothers are the scourge of the internet.
It's always my kid brother did it, or it's my so-and-so just died. And
I'm sorry, I'm in a really bad mood because so-and-so died, and I was just...
I'm going through a really rough patch.
I'm going through tough times.
So I thought I'd take it on everyone else anonymously.
So I thought I'd send this shock image out. I don't know.
We've heard it all before.
Dealing with my grief.
The thing, too, is like, you know that dad went home and said, well, I hope your buddies like the movie you made of Halo 3 because they can buy you Christmas presents this year.
Yeah, no shit.
Dad's going to be on the unemployment line.
All right. Anything else we had to talk about before we wrap up?
I guess not. Oh. You guys didn't see V yet, did you?
No. Nope.
All right, well, why don't you guys... I'm going to give you guys homework. Go watch V, and then we can talk about it next week.
Right. Go watch three seasons of Mad Men, since you're giving me that homework.
All right, I'll do that. I'll watch one episode of V, and I'll watch three seasons of Mad Men.
I have one thing to say about V. It's like, well, maybe I should just wait for it. I'll just wait
for it.
Sure. Okay. All right. Well, thanks for listening, everyone.
Toodles.
They're aliens. Spoiler.
Oh, shit. Wait, ready? It's a drunk tank. With Gus and Jeff and Bernie and Joel and Matt and other people like Gavino. It's a dream tank.